Hello everyone, welcome to Hard Fork, where we talk about all things crypto, everything blockchain. I'm your host Shantanu. We are live from Genesis Devcon, India's largest blockchain developer conference yet. This is happening in Bengaluru. On this episode, we're going to talk about and explore the space of decentralized finance, or DeFi as is known. We are seeing a virtual explosion of sorts in which, you know, we are seeing that the multiple traditional financial instruments are, you know, coming onto the DeFi space or the blockchain space. And one of these, there's a new protocol called Kyber Network, which is giving the much needed boost in this sector. And to talk about DeFi and Kyber Network is its own product head today with us here in the studio at Genesis DevCon. Please welcome on the show Mr. Sunny Jain from Kyber Network. Sunny.
Hi, welcome nice to meet you. Nice I'm meet so you. Delighted to be here.
I'm very glad that I'm talking to Kyber Network. You know, once I learned about Kyber, I was trying to figure out a DeFi space because, you know, we heard about Nuo Network coming on this, and we also heard about InstaDApp getting hooked on to Kyber Network. So it piqued my interest. So why don't you tell our viewers what exactly is the problem that Kyber Network is trying to solve?
Okay, so just starting with the very basics. So, you know, when you talk about liquidity in financial markets, so, you know, liquidity is that the ease with which one you can convert one asset to another. And when you want to do this on blockchain, and that's what we call a decentralized liquidity. So what Kyber, but one of the key problem or challenge that blockchain has, that this liquidity is very scattered on the blockchain. So for example, there are multiple reserves on the blockchain that are offering you a service of converting one asset into another asset. So when as a user or as a developer, you build a dApp that want to access that liquidity, you are expected to go all of these reserves one by one to figure it out, what who is giving the best rate, who can handle the quantity that you want to swap. So that's the challenge that Kyber is trying to solve. What Kyber has built, a protocol that aggregate liquidity from all those resources. All right. So right now we are aggregating liquidity from 45 resources.
All right. And these are across different coins
Across
or tokens?
Different coins. Yeah, we have 70 plus coins that we are supporting. Mm-hmm. And we pull all those liquidity into single resource.
Okay.
And not only that, when the user, so now user doesn't have to go to all these resources. They can justly come to us, to Kyber. Mm-hmm. Kyber help you to get your, let's say, asset exchange service into one of these liquidity resources. But that's what Kyber handle. And Kyber guarantees you the best result out of this 45 or best rate, I would say, out of this 45 resources. So that's what the challenge that Kyber is trying to solve. Okay. So in a very nutshell, Kyber is a protocol running on Ethereum blockchain at the moment that aggregates liquidity from different resources, pull them into one pool. And when the user come to us to swap their token, we get them the best rate from this liquidity pool. So it's actually, in technical level, it's just one function call. That's all you have to do. And then Kyber takes care of everything.
Awesome. So it's interesting when you say the best rates, okay? Because we all understand that it's a pretty volatile market. On any kind of coin, it goes to extreme levels of volatility, all right? And if you have 45 reserves and the user coming on, there's a lot of risk when it comes to the price and the risk to the reserve, which is there, right? How are you ensuring that risk is taken care of?
Okay, so that would require me to go slightly into technical detail.
Please, by all means,
So let me just explain you what is the best rate. For example, let's take the simple case example. You want to swap, you convert your Ether to USDC.
Fair enough.
Okay, so USDC is a stable coin.
Yeah.
And let's say a user want to do one Ether to USDC conversion.
Okay.
And there are two reserves and Kyber, like on this 45 reserve, two reserves are offering the same exchange service.
All right.
One of them is giving one Ether to 150 USDC. Mm-hmm. Another one is giving 151.
All right.
So Kyber will then pick the 151 because that is best for the user.
Okay.
So that's what I meant by best rate.
Mm-hmm.
Now, coming to the second part, that how do we manage the risk or the volatility, right? So let's say, because there are two things, right? When Kyber, so Kyber do the market making. So if a reserve has both USDC and Ethereum, we help to determine what would be the best suitable exchange rate.
Okay.
And we make sure that it is reflecting what is the rate in the market.
All right.
So Kyber can do this for reserve, and reserve can do it for by himself as well. So
the reserve can do it on himself also.
Yeah, yeah. So we give a very flexible model for reserve managers if they want to provide liquidity.
Mm-hmm.
So now the third part is, let's say there is a scenario when a user does a very big trade.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's say it is like 1,000 Ether worth of trade.
Okay.
Now what it will do, it will create an imbalance in the reserve. Okay. There will be a lot of Ether supply to the reserve and a lot of USDC will go. Now, when this imbalance happens, so there is a possibility that the market making capability will distort the price and it will not reflect the actual price.
It could.
So the Kyber has an inbuilt mechanism that when this kind of thing happens, we'll block the trading on that reserve.
All right.
Unless, until there's an external price feed coming and correcting the price. So.
And that happens in real time? That can happen in real time?
Yeah, that's happening in real time. I think the delay is like one block time, so 15 seconds.
Of course, 15 seconds.
So that's how we protect the reserve from this uncertainty.
Mm-hmm.
So every time, let's say a user does a very big trade, creating an imbalance, so we block the trading temporarily unless an external price feed coming and correcting the price.
Oh.
That's one way we do it. And the second way we do it, that if there is too much of volatility in the ether, okay, let's say it just move in 1 second too much.
Yeah.
Then also we block it.
Okay. So you block the price coming, the input coming from the different exchanges.
So we block the trading from that reserve.
Oh, you block the trading itself.
Yeah.
All right. So that protects the reserve itself.
Yes.
Also, you know, it at least ensures there's no imbalance happening in the entire.
Yes.
That's an excellent risk capability. I think this has been really well thought out.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So you're right now only supporting the ERC-20 protocol coins as such.
But yes, right now we are supporting around 70 plus ERC-20 token.
Mm-hmm.
And we keep on adding new tokens as the industry evolve.
Okay.
But on top of that, Kyber is also working on cross-chain capabilities.
Okay.
In that respect, Kyber is right now working on Ethereum and EOS chain cross compatibility.
Okay.
We have released our research paper called Waterloo.
Okay.
The project is called Waterloo.
Okay. Okay.
The thing is that Kyber is very much into decentralization. So we wanted to have the complete, let's say you want to swap Ethereum to EOS, which are running on two different blockchain.
Mm-hmm.
So we wanted to have this operation completely decentralized in a trustless manner.
Fair enough.
The key challenge that we have is that for example, when you swap Ether to EOS, okay, you give Ether to us, we lock them into a smart contract, then a smart contract on the EOS chain should be notified that somebody wants to do that. So then that's the research paper is all about, that how do we then send a signal from Ethereum blockchain to EOS blockchain that somebody wants to swap one Ether. Then we mint.
Now this is going to happen directly from the Ether chain to EOS chain.
Yes, it's happening in the real time without any centralized server or any third party. It's happening on the blockchain.
So then how do I don't think reserves are going to come in play there, right?
So
it's going to be a peer to peer kind of stuff.
Or no, would it not be? It will still be reserve.
Okay, still be a reserve. Yeah. All right. Okay.
So then they will mint an Ethereum equivalent on EOS.
Okay.
And then we swap it to EOS.
Yeah,
and that EOS will go to the user's wallet.
Wow, I think many people are doing this cross-chain swapping, right?
Yes, and the beauty is that you can easily do it when you involve a centralized server.
Mm-hmm.
But doing it in a completely decentralized manner, that is the beauty of that research.
Okay.
We have been working on it. We have released a POC.
Mm-hmm.
It's working. We did a swap from KNC to EOS, I believe.
Okay.
And the code is on the GitHub. The paper is on the Medium. So anyone is happy to use it, read it, use the code, make it better.
Okay.
Our team in Israel is continuously working on it.
Okay,
and
awesome.
We hope to
awesome.
Release that in 2020 probably.
Oh wow! So I think this is fantastic, news for the developers out there. And if you're looking at doing something on Kyber Network, this is a fantastic thing to work on. The paper is available on GitHub as well as on Medium. You should go through and read it and find out what you can do for yourself. Good, thank good information. As a follow-up to this idea of the developer coming on and trying to experiment on the Kyber Network, the swap that you're looking at off-chain or cross-chain, as a developer, as a person who is just about starting his journey, okay, as a developer and wants to get on to blockchain per se, what is Kyber Network? How can Kyber Network contribute to his journey as a blockchain developer?
I think that's a very interesting question, and that's the question I have been asked a lot
by
almost like in every conference that I go to. So let me just explain this question, like assuming that there's a developer who has never exposed himself to blockchain, but he's interested to start his journey into it.
Okay.
And I think that will cover all spectrum of developers.
Fair enough. Yeah.
So, and this is like my personal story that how I started into blockchain, right?
Mm-hmm.
So first of all, like if you look at Kyber, right, and our developer portal, we give you three options on how do you use Kyber Network to build something.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll explain you in terms of very easy to the least easy way.
Fair enough.
So the most easy one is the API level. So you can use Kyber APIs to interact with Kyber platform, which is running on smart blockchain.
Okay.
So in that way, you are not writing anything on, like you're not writing any smart contract. You're not interacting directly with the blockchain. You are just calling an API endpoint. And nowadays, every developer knows that how to use API. It's a simple HTTP link.
Fair enough. Okay, sounds good. Yeah.
That's a very simple way. And I think if if a decent developer can build an app in 1 week. A simple mm-hmm. Kyber swap replica can be built in 1 week. Mm-hmm. And some of the innovative use cases that you can make a trading board, you can make an arbitrage board. It's very simple, as long as you know JavaScript, any programming language, just call API endpoint and that's done.
Okay.
So once you've done it, that's a very simple case. Now you get exposed yourself to, you understand a little bit how Ethereum works and everything. And then I advise people to move from API to our JavaScript library. Not okay. our, it's like Web3.js.
Web3.js library.
It's
okay.
open, right?
Okay, yeah.
That also let you interact with smart contract on blockchain, but you are not writing any smart contract. You're still outside blockchain, but you are interacting. So that gives you a gateway to interact with blockchain. And
is this all like a tutorial kind of stuff, or was it like, or it's actually the tools available right away?
Yes, the tools available. Just search Google Kyber Developer Portal. We have ready-made code that you can just copy paste and run it.
All right. Okay.
Okay. And works on testnet and mainnet both.
Okay.
Then I think I advise people to start working with Web3.js. That's slightly higher than API.
Okay.
Okay. Once they are comfortable with Web3.js, right? In fact, I would advise like 60 to 70% of the application, right? Mm-hmm. You can just build completely over Web3.js. You don't even write, you don't need to write smart contract.
Mm.
There are, if as long as you know how to use smart contract using Web3.js, you can build really killer apps. And I can actually, if you come to Kyber, right, there are multiple apps mm-hmm. and that have been built completely using that, like Engine Wallet, one of the very famous wallet. I think Samsung smartphone has that as a native wallet, pre-installed in certain countries. Mm-hmm. Engine Wallet has been using completely that way of interacting with Kyber.
Awesome.
They have not written any smart contract to use Kyber.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where people can do it.
Okay.
That's the second level.
Okay.
So once you've done it, the third level is that now you're expert, now you can write smart contract.
Okay.
And even in fact, you know, if you look at, let's say, Maker, right? I think the most complex smart contract has 1,000 lines of code.
Okay.
So even if you are very expert in smart contract and you're building an innovative app, at max, you will be writing 2 or 3 smart contract.
Okay.
Most of your stuff will still involve Web3.js and APIs. So you need to have that journey. Okay. So that's the journey that I propose to the user.
Okay.
If they do it, I think within a quarter, like 3 months or 4 months, they will be an expert of it. And they will not be intimidated by all those smart contracts and compilation and everything.
Yeah, yeah.
And you know, Kyber has done a great job in it, but we provide ready-made codes for you to give it a try, you know, and then, you know, take copy paste. And in fact, Kyber is all open source.
Yeah, it's open source, so you can actually experiment whatever you want, and you have a testnet, so you can go on testnet and do it. Okay, fantastic.
Even Kyber Swap, right? Our iOS and Android app is completely open source as well. Mm. If someone wants, can just take our Android app and deploy it on Play Store and can have his own app, just change the name.
Oh, wow.
If somebody wants to do that, they can do that. But that's the thing, right? We don't want to own this way. We are tech, right?
Yeah,
we are a protocol. We want people to build on that protocol. Kyber Swap is just a demonstration of how it works.
Yeah.
But I mean, there are other 83 applications that haven't done so. So
wow.
We are more interested into that.
Awesome. Yeah. So I think, you know, I think the developer should take a leaf out of Sunny's journey here and, you know, try the methodology he talked about. You know, start API and then Web3.js and then, of course, get into proper development of smart contracts using the tools that they already have on Kyber Network Developer Portal, right?
Yeah.
Awesome. Then let's come to a point wherein I want to get into one, of course, is, you know, the onboarding of the various dApps you have. You said there are 70 odd coins and there are, how many dApps do you have actually?
83 plus. That's 80, what I know.
Okay, 83 plus. Yeah. Let's assume 80 plus dApps are there on Kyber Network. What is the onboarding process of DeFi dApps? They're all DeFi dApps, right? They have some, you know, to do with finance. So what is the onboarding process of dApps onto Kyber Network?
So actually, it's pretty simple. Mm-hmm. So first of all, let's say if you're using Kyber Smart Contract and build an app that is using our asset exchange service via smart contract, right? There may be so many apps that are not even telling us and they've been using us and we don't know and it doesn't matter to us, right? So that's one way, right?
The second
way is that let's say you build an app and then using Kyber and then you come to us. Okay, so there is this app we have built. And, you know, then we talk to them people and if we like them, then we actually, so in terms of onboarding, right? So we help them, you know, sometime like help them into brainstorming their business model.
Mm-hmm.
And if let's say, like there was one example, there was one guy who was pretty good in backend tech, but he didn't have the capability of front end. We help him to do a little bit of designing as well.
Fair enough. So there's a lot of advice coming from you guys also.
We do it. And then because we have like 100,000 followers on our Twitter, if the app is really good, we don't mind tweeting them and asking our our community to, you know, support those apps.
All right.
So we do a lot of this kind of thing, and then we even send you some of our swags, you know, just to motivate you.
Uh-huh.
And in some of the cases that if you are lack of funds, we are also willing to, you know, to step into that part of it.
Awesome. So you not only provide the advice, you also, you know, fund
marketing,
the marketing
growth,
fund and everything.
Yeah.
Awesome. This is fantastic. I think this is going to be a fantastic conversation, but I can't, you know, keep on talking about this.
Yes.
Good. I think my last question would definitely be, you know, the scope of DeFi. Now, you've been in, you're an Indian, you're from Panipat in Haryana.
Yeah.
And now, the question here is, we only have, right, on Nuo and InstaDab on Kyber Network. Yeah, you are here scouting for more, I believe, in Genesis DevCon. Awesome. So, what is the scope that you see in India and elsewhere, of course, in DeFi? I'm more interested in to know about Indian.
Okay.
DeFi.
I think overall DeFi is pretty hot topic in the whole blockchain space
no
at
doubt.
The moment.
Yeah.
And I think in India, I see huge opportunities in that way. So first of all, because of the enormous tech talent that we have, and you know, and because blockchain is still in a very naive, and I think it's a very early stage. And so, and first of all, you can build like really good value adding financial application over blockchain without having a big team. And that's the beauty. Like InstaDab was started with two guys. I think Nuo are three.
Yeah.
And like both of them are the huge success story of Indian, and that should motivate a lot of developers to build.
Yeah.
I mean, DeFi is basically putting a traditional banking process over blockchain.
Yes, yes.
So I can with confidence say that like one or two guys can actually build a whole bank or a blockchain. You don't need 200 people to run that operation.
Yeah, and so with all that open source technology available, it's so easy to deploy and on and test and work on it.
So that way, I think, looking at the financial system, you know, lot of cases that happened in India previously, I think that should attract a lot of people to, you know, to create more robust cases to, you know, adding value to the people. Take just simple example, you know, one of the like some financial dApps are offering like 6 to 7% interest rate on US dollar.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, even in US, you can't get it.
You can't get it.
And on US dollar, that is like that is amazing. And like some of the tokens even offering 15-16% interest rate.
Yes.
And the good thing is that you're not trusting a company when you're depositing your money. You're trusting a smart contract,
which
is a code. It will always work the way it works.
Yeah,
it cannot change. No one can change it. It's open source. You can read it.
Yeah.
You know. So the whole trustless nature and, you know, the value it is adding, you know, initially when the whole blockchain and the Ethereum started, there were a lot of apps coming for trading purposes, but now it has been moving and giving more value addition to the user. Like if I want, like a lot of people assume that, you know, there's a lot of fluctuation in Ethereum price, I would be exposed to more risk, but that's not true.
Yeah.
You have stable coins. You can, if you want, you can have all your crypto in the stable coins. So it doesn't matter where ETH is, the value will always be the same.
Be same, yeah.
Deposit into a, you know, like let's say Nuo and earn interest rate. You don't have to do anything. And actually it's a wealth creation because US dollars, it doesn't depreciate.
Yeah.
And then, you know, and then interest rate, it has already inbuilt inflation and everything.
Yeah.
So it's actually a wealth appreciation.
Yeah, actually, of course. I mean, talking about DeFi per se, I was interacting with somebody on another episode.
Yeah.
And wherein I said that, you know, this is probably a very good example wherein a person can use their own crypto, which are lying idle and probably subject to the volatility of the entire trades.
Mm.
And put it into a place where you know you get passive income coming from through interest. I think this is a fantastic idea. I think.
You and let me give one example for developers to build upon. So I was just talking to someone on my booth. These guys are making POS system, and you know they receive money from the banks, and then they do some account reconciliation and give it to the merchant. So for a 3 days period, they have this money sitting idle with them.
Oh no!
I said that, why you are having this idle? Why don't you convert them into a stable coin and deposit into one of the DeFi dApps and earn interest for 3 days? It's not like a traditional bank where you have a fixed deposit of 3 months you can't withdraw. You earn interest every 15-20 seconds. So you can even deposit money for 1 hour and earn money.
Yeah, I think, but I think the issue lies in, you know, them being able to convert that into a stable coin. You know, this is Indian, the regulations are still in the gray area. I think the government needs to really work towards ensuring such kind of you know, such dApps and such new startups get the opportunity to be able to create value, okay, yeah, and of course, you know, add value to the system.
Yeah. And I'm thinking, I'm like, our government will definitely is like, definitely they have been tracking this industry, yeah, and when they see the real value adding, I mean, they won't be like, you know, just sitting, yeah, idle. They would come.
I'm sure they are tracking it, and I'm sure they are very robust, because yeah, my interactions have been that they are very pro.
Yes.
Okay. A lot of things. Mm. It's just that probably I think they are biding the time right now to, yeah, see how this goes and maybe create something much more robust as a regulation. I'm very optimistic.
Yeah, me too. Government. I mean, looking at all the initiative that the government has taken, like be Digital India, Make in India, yeah, very tech pro. All the UPI is a revolution.
Yeah, yeah.
I have not seen in any other country. Yeah, so yeah, I think sooner or later the government will win. You know. Will set up a proper procedure around.
Absolutely. So we have our Prime Minister Mr. Modi. He also keeps on talking about, you know, blockchain and the uses of AI and ML, yes, and the emerging technologies, how it can help us and all. He's always very pro digital. I think, yeah, probably we'll see some good time coming, yeah, in front of us in maybe next year onwards.
Yes, for all sure. Right.
This year
I'm really looking forward for it.
Ah, me too. Yes, of course. Yes, Sunny. Wonderful talking to you, and you know, I wish we could have kept on talking. Maybe we'll do it offline, and you know, we'll discuss more about DeFi and the future DeFi here.
Yeah.
Good to have you on Hard Fork at Genesis DevCon. Thank you so much for your time. Much appreciated, man. I will look forward.
I really want to thank you for starting this thing, and I think this is a very great platform for other developers and even like people who are involved into blockchain to get insight from people. And you know, I'm like, I've watched some of your videos, that the people that you get from different spaces, yeah, talking about blockchain, it's really good, and it's really different from the other one where they're explaining about the product, a lot of videos around that, but actually getting about people, what they think about blockchain, how the industry is evolving and all this thing.
Yes.
I think it's a good way to keep updated myself, at least with the blockchain space, what other people are doing and how they are doing it.
I'm so glad you like it. Thank you so much for your time, and you know, for appreciating what we do. I hope we get more time and space to work.
Next time, maybe.
All right. Yeah. Thank you so much, Sunny. Wonderful talking to you.
Same here.
So, ladies and gentlemen, that was Sunny Jain from Kyber Network. He's the product head with them. Talking to us about the space of DeFi and how Kyber Network works and how it can benefit the developers out there. And this is Shantanu Sharma from Hard Fork, live from Genesis DevCon, Bengaluru. We'll see you on the other side. Thank you. Bye-bye.